Now, William Trevor died in November last year. He's 88 years old. He entered the college under his real name, Trevor William Cox, in January 1944. There's a photocopy of the register he signed down there. Trevor William Cox, birth date, and then father, J.W. Cox, Esquire, Bank of Ireland, and Scorpy, County Wexford. In the 1980s, I was the literary coordinator of the Kenny Arts Week, and I wrote to Trevor at his address in Devon asking him to read at the festival. A courteous letter arrived a few weeks later, accepting the invitation. I picked him up at the Kenny railway station and accompanied him for the rest of the day for his reading in the castle in the evening. He was great company, and as everyone says, is charming, a gentleman that you can meet. But very fast, he found out that he became particularly interested in me because he found out that A, I was an old Columban, and B, had just started teaching at the school again, and he was just pumped me for information. He was fascinated about the place. He wanted more decades after he left. He was fascinated by all schools, whether they're real or fictional, and they appear again and again in his writing. Sandford Park, which he went to before this, it's a grammar school in the fantastic novella Knights at the Alhambra. It's a Swiss finishing school, in the loose sense, in Fools of Fortune, which is run by a really creepy couple of bachelors. The Tate boarding school in Wexford he went to. It's quote, all food tasted of rust. It's an old girls comprehensive. There's Elm Park Prep School near Armagh in two pieces, one called Apply Directly to the Headmaster. And just brilliantly funny one called The Insatiable Roach Quinn, which is a portrayal of a bunch of teachers you really wouldn't want to let your child hear. It flows soon after that. In the essay, Schools in the Blood, he refers to my obsession with schools and life in school. So much so that in 1978, Lemon Tree Press produced this book, long after print, unfortunately, the punningly titled Old School Ties, which is a collection of his writings about schools. That was 40 years before he died, and there's lots more material to come. This was a writer whose first major novel, The Old Boys, strictly speaking, second one, usually regards his first, was about how men in their 70s were still acting out the kind of psychodramas of their childhood in school. And the very last story in was two volumes, these are the collected stories, it was one volume only, almost 1,000 pages. The very last story in that is called Folie à deux, and is about two middle-aged men in Paris meeting each other again accidentally. The last time they met each other was as boys in cloisters before chapel. And on the first page of Old School Ties is a fragment called At the Convent, which I want to read out about his very, very early school. As a child, I attended a convent in Yule, one of a tiny handful of boys in the lowest form. We didn't feel, as such young boys don't particularly, members of a minority group in an overwhelmingly female world, nor did I, occupying as the only Protestant a second minority area within the first, feel an outcast or in any sense peculiar. During prayers and lessons that touched upon religion, I talked to the lay sisters in the kitchen and was often given small pieces of pink marzipan. Touched by this attention, I bought them gifts in return, oranges and a pack of raisins, which I collected from Miss Needs, a shop in which the goods were free. You just said what you wanted, I explained to the lay sisters, and Miss Needs wrote something down in the book. The lay sisters laughed, but made me take my presents back. Such small incidents I remember vividly, with the smell of floor polish and the Reverend Mother's worn, elderly face and the glowing cheeks of Sister Tracy, a country girl. When I look back on that convent in Yule, I experience a wave of happiness. Or a very common phrase in his writing. This was the first, the kind of original Eden of a school, a motherly, kind of kindly, protected place, completely innocent of any kind of form of difference, where he wasn't yet an outsider, and he didn't feel, as he once said, as a man who was on the periphery. Next time was Miss Willoughby's schoolroom in Skibbereen, where he learned, where at first I learned the world is not an easygoing place. And probably the biggest theme of all in Trevor's writing is time, the way it relentlessly erodes, the way it creates loss everywhere. accounts for the kind of pervasive sense of memory we often use writing. And schools are institutions in which time can seem to move quickly sometimes and stand still as well, which is a place where sometimes, well, I hope you want to get away from, and yet when you've left, sometimes you want to return. His final school as a boy, and he did teach a little bit, which I'll come to, was St. Columba's. And it's worth considering why this one, above all, was the one which so greatly influenced his writing. Like that first different school in Yule, it was a place which seemed to absorb difference, which was, to some extent, kind of tolerant. But this time it was last stop before adulthood, and certainly wasn't an innocent experience. In between, there were lots of other schools and periods of no schooling at all. St. Columba seems to have provided some kind of stability in an unsettled childhood. As I said, his father was a bank manager, moved around the country, so that their homes kept changing. And it became increasingly clear in his teenage years that his parents' marriage was deeply unhappy. In his own words, "In all sorts of ways, it was at St. Columba's where I first became aware that black and white are densities of more complicated grains." Before I move on to the college itself directly, as a quick jump forward, Trevor didn't arrive here in the usual route in those days, which was through one of the kind of established prep schools like Arvin, Castle Park, Brookhouse. But he did teach in a prep school, in fact, more than one prep school. And he says about this, "Perhaps if I had been as a boy at prep school, I would not have found its small world so extraordinary. I drifted into that world as a teacher and eventually drifted out again." He talks being in Trinity, he did a history degree, but then he decided to become a doctor. He said, "I had been a medical student for 24 hours, but being then borne in on me that curing the sick was a mistaken vocation, I considered becoming a veterinary surgeon, but in time recalled my fear of cats." If you know the old boys, he took his revenge on cats in that book, because there's this kind of monster called Monmouth, this moggy, who ends up in a really very sticky end in a dustbin. "The TCD careers officer sent me to see a man who manufactured telephone boxes. He said that, strictly speaking, he was looking for a qualified engineer. In the end, I answered an advertisement of the Irish Independent that stated that a lady was looking for someone to teach her backward daughter to read and write. Suit a nun, it suggested. The lady explained to me over tea in the Royal Automobile Club in Dawson Street, well, I mean, we had someone female in mind. I mean, a nun, or an ex-nun, something like that. I said I thought I could do as well as a nun or ex-nun, and the lady in the end said that I just supposed I could. So for a while, I travelled out of Dublin daily on a bus as a personal tutor at the countryside. And I don't have time to go through subsequent experience in prep schools, but I'll say that writing about that is just brilliantly funny. He moved on then to some schools in England, including secondary schools after Ellen Park, where he drifted into the advertising industry. But the seeds of the artistic life that was sown here took a little while to flower, but he did retain fond memories of his teaching years. And there's a really brilliant interview he did in the Paris Review in 1989 with Mira Stout. And he said this here, "I liked teaching maths best, because I don't have a natural way with figures, therefore I had sympathy with the children who didn't either. And I greatly respected the ones who possessed that attitude. My skill in art and English made me impatient, and I found those subjects rather dreary to teach as a result. A headmaster asked me once, why are the art room walls covered with pictures of such ugly women? Why have some of them got those horrible cigarette butts hanging out of their nostrils? I explained that I had asked the children to paint the ugliest woman they could think of." You know where this is going. Unfortunately, almost all of them had looked no further than the headmaster's wife. And in the end, I say, I like that devilish thing in children. So on to this place. Unlike its predecessor, Sandwich Park, which are only 11 or 12 boarders, this was a complete boarding environment, a world entire of itself. Perhaps the first true community he'd been in since that conference school in Yule. And this is what he said. "Schools came and went. The last one I went to was St. Columba's, set high in the Dublin mountains. It was, and still is, the only public school of its kind in the Republic of Ireland. Famous for much, but most of all, for skill on the hockey pitch. In its big, beautiful Deer Park, There is a ruined summer house where Robert Emmet was said to have courted Sarah Curran. We used it as a shelter from the wind, crouched low among the blocks of stone, smoking our wartime American cigarettes. When first I arrived, I was impressed by the presence of a butler, who's the real-life character called Flood, who appears in Fools of Fortune as a character called Fuchs, and a vast number of maids, one of whom is known as the Bicycle. receiving me with a handful of other new boys, the headmaster showed us a tiny watercolour which he said was probably by turn, and a chest that he had been, he thought, the property of Anne Boleyn. and a rectangular object beneath glass that was believed to have been in the possession of St. Columba. The chapel, said the headmaster, who was Warden Stovey, is the centre of school life. I should like you to remember that. He did, and both that sentence and the chapel itself repeatedly feature in his writings, along with a detail which he's obsessed by, which is that one of the favourite pupil pastime, not giving ideas here to the fifth and sixth one, was flicking butter pats upwards and trying to get them to stick to the diamond ball ceiling. The Columba magazine doesn't give many hints of what was to come. Trevor William Cox appeared first in the Hillary Term edition of 1944, arriving less than a year after the departure of Michael Campbell, who is author of the single most sustained literary treatment of this place, his best-selling 1967 novel, Lord Dismiss Us. He wins two awards which point the way to the future, the Warden's Prize for wood carving and for sculpture. Is named best maiden speaker in a debate in which he, quote, asked the House if they did not think that behind a fleshy exterior there was something permanent, a soul which would be free to roam after death. And in a later debate on the partition of Ireland, the report says, it was perfectly obvious that partition was a great evil, and he, Cox, advocated the extermination of the people in the six counties. Well, it's definitely devilishness in those comments. There's no mention of him in literary society reports. And he makes it onto Rugby First to 15, where his play tells his zest and abandon. One teacher in particular had a huge influence on him, the renowned sculptor Oisin Kelly, then taught art, French, and Irish here, whom he writes vividly about vividly in the essay Mentors, which is in Excursion in the Real World. This is his description of that teacher. In the art room, he didn't fulsomely encourage. His example of doing rather than thinking, his dislike of the amateur, his distrust of philosophy, of the cerebral and academic, weren't thrust upon you. They were there. You shared them or you didn't. You stood on your own two feet. He was impatient and tetchy and down to earth. You weren't put in the world to be pampered. If you wanted to learn, listen to what was being said to you. If you didn't, no one else was going to fret. For some years, Trevor became a professional sculptor. He did the War Memorial dance at Anne's church in Dorset Street. Oisin Kelly's values may well have persisted in then and later. As an author, he was definitely a man who disdained cerebral, academic, the flashy. He worked hard, produced a huge body of work, so almost 2,000 pages of short stories alone the novels, and has always beautifully shaped. And in the Paris Review, he said, I have no messages or anything like that. I have no philosophy. I don't impose on my characters anything more than the predicament they find themselves in. And when he says this, I have to create for the novel a tremendous amount of raw material and then cut the novel out of it. I think probably he echoes Michelangelo's famous statement that every block of stone has a statue inside it, and it is the task of the sculptor to discover that. That seems a pretty good metaphor for Trevor's writing. And so many of his short stories have within them the possibilities of entire novels. In 20 pages, he gives what many other authors would have turned into a 400-page book. And an autobiographical essay, which has this density as well, which I was talking to Joe about just beforehand, is what I think is his best piece of non-fiction, which is the brilliant essay called The Warden's Wife, from 1992, in Excursions in the Real World. He says this, setting the scene. Gowns were worn in the classroom and in dining hall, surplices and chapel on Sundays. The gowns covered the top half of the body only, and somewhat inadequately, but were useful for smuggling slices of bread to toast in the furnace room, for soaking up spills and polishing shoes. Traditionally, no junior was permitted to walk around with his hands in his pockets. Traditionally, on St. Patrick's Day, the entire school, even the stout housekeeper, the cook, the bursar, secretary, and the two school nurses, assisted in the planting of potatoes. Traditionally, there were cockfights, one boy perched on another's shoulders lashing out at a pair of rivals, and cloister cricket, and words with local meanings, different from the accepted ones, and small idiosyncrasies of behaviour. Traditionally, the first fruits of the potato planting were eaten on St. Columba's Day. In spite of its crème de la crème reputation, St. Columba's in 1944 was a genuine microcosm. You didn't have to be clever there. When it chose to, it became a world of its own. And this is a brilliant detail. If you don't know what double saving time was, this was in the war, an attempt to save to energy saving, in which Britain and the continent had exactly the same time zone, so there wasn't an hour difference. So, he's right, double saving time was kept one summer, clocked an hour ahead of standard Irish time. So we had our own time zone. When you grabbed the iron, it was an hour ahead. No bathing attire was ever worn in the hilltop swimming pool up there by boys or masters, since no one ever passed by. The school's meat was slaughtered on the premises. It supplied all the vegetables and milk. And then he goes on to describe Mrs. Sobey, Mrs. Mary Sobey. Once she had been beautiful. I often heard that said during my 2 years at St. Columba's, and perhaps it was true. All that was certain was that no beauty remained. He's fascinated by this plainly highly intelligent person who has kind of has become the warden's wife, who doesn't even have her own name anymore, whose individuality has been kind of suppressed. And reading of her death in Canada in 1989, he was startled to discover that during her time at college, she'd become an expert in matters of the turf, regularly attending race meetings. The time's too short, but it is a brilliant piece. He's forensically perceptive. Just the sort of pupil you don't want in your own class. Writing about you 20 years later. Now, the third of the essays in Excursions of the Real World about College is another gem, which is called Long Stuart, which is an affectionate account of Kenneth J. Stuart from Boyle, County Roscommon. His family is still part of the school community. His grand-niece, grand-nephew are here, with whom Trevor kept in touch until Stuart's death also in 1989. Thanks to his nephew, Neil, who yesterday emailed me some photos of his St. Columba's recurs throughout the fiction. While school incidents in the old boys probably weren't taken from his time here, much of the background clearly is. On old boys' day, there's a chapel service, a cricket match, an evening dinner. Mr. Knox glanced around the dining hall. It hadn't changed since last year. It hadn't changed very much since he was a boy. The ceiling still stained with the marks of butter flicked there from the points of knives. Versions of college appear in short stories like Mr. McNamara, Torridge, Family Sins, Traditions, and Folie à Deux. But the most extended treatment in the college in the fiction in the novels is in his 1983 novel, Fools of Fortune. And that central character is called Willie Quinton. Lives in another kind of Eden, which is his house in County Cork called Kilnay, with his parents, siblings, his aunts, and his tutor, the very sympathetic, defrocked priest, Father Kilgarra. Willie's father repeatedly says to his son that he will go to the school he'd been at himself in the Dublin mountains. For Willie, this was a source of mild terror, a threat rather than the opportunity that his father considers it to be. And he imagines being beaten by a bamboo cane, and then fantasizes that the local GP will declare he is too delicate for a place like that. And hopes his mother will protect him from the grim establishment founded in 1843. Mm-hmm. That's what Trevor is apologising for, maybe. And he goes all right after fire destroys his house and kills most of his family. Chapter 5, and all chapter 5 and most of chapter 6 are set here. Exposed to the winds that swept across the gorse-laden hillsides, the school was a cloistered world of its own, not just physically chilly, but a place where there's little innocence. The warden and teachers also again have vividly evoked the drawing room, which all our visitors are invited to come and have a glass and a chat afterwards. Down the main house is featured. And in chapter 6, Willie is the great summer of his life as he falls in love with his cousin Marianne. He can't talk, of the purity of his feelings with anyone who would understand my feelings and my diffidence. He finds an unlikely confessor in the figure of the timeless butler Fuchs. Loving the school as no one else did, he never left it and was inordinately proud both of his servant status and his loyalty. So Trevor William Cox left here in the summer of 1946. There's an essay in the 1964 edition of the London magazine called Leaving School, which he cannibalized to use for other essays, describing the experience. And his feelings were ambivalent, like many people are leaving school. He prepares to go out into the post-school world. In the chapel there is a great roar as we sang the end of term hymn, "Those returning make more faithful than before." Every time we'd heard those words in the past, we imagined the day when we would sing them for the last time, when we'd roar them out because we would not now be more faithful than before, because we were not returning. The words are from the hymn Lord Dismiss Us, which Michael Campbell took as the title of his novel. The reality is quite as thrilling as he'd hoped. School was forever over, yet school persisted. The present days and the ones that were promised seemed dull and disappointing. At school I had a position. I had sat at the end of the table in dining hall. I had given out biscuits at break. An outsider, he originally turned down the warden's offer of prefecture, had become one of us. He found his vocation eventually, and over 50 years produced an extraordinary body of work of the very highest quality that I think will last. It's a work of great variety, covering a huge range of characters, places and events. Schools run like a thread through the work, and one school in particular colours that thread more than anywhere else. Well, I'm going to finish with an extract from the old one. It quotes a housemaster, a very aged, experienced housemaster in that book, called H.L. Downs. "The school may do as it likes," he said. "It may keep its own time. It may be almost entirely self-supporting. It may train its own army, print and publish its own propaganda. It may invent traditions, laws, and myths. At the school, a man once told the boys in his care that New Guinea was part of Canada. That steps, S-T-E-P-P-E-S, that steps were steps. That the Danube flowed through Spain. He used no textbooks, and allowed only the maps he drew himself on the blackboard. They found him out eventually. But many still carry with him his strange geographical images. School belonged to itself, adapting what it decided it required. A miniature of the world, said H.L. Dowse to every new boy he interviewed. But once, later in his life, he said instead, the world is the school.